Hello there, I'm Lee from Educative. Welcome to Educative Sessions. If you like this episode, please be sure to click the like button below wherever it may be. Also, don't forget to subscribe and get reminders on future content. Enjoy. Hello everyone and welcome to Educative Sessions, a podcast series with people in the developer world about their coding experiences. This is brought to you by Educative, which makes it easy for authors to provide interactive and adaptive courses for software developers. My name is Li Ngo, and I am the host of Educative Sessions. And today, my guest is Dmitry Vostokov, who wants to talk a lot about errors and errors alerts and the whole world of trace and log analysis. Dmitry, welcome to the show.
Okay, thank you, Li. My name is Dmitry, and I would like to talk about trace and log analysis, and especially about patterns, how to use successfully trace and log analysis, and everything about that.
Yes, yes. Let's begin. Let's start with the dumb question. What is trace and log analysis, right? And why is this so interesting to you that you've wanted to focus, say, an entire career on this?
Okay. Let me put the question of what trace and log analysis is in some example context. So suppose you deploy your application or service to some production environment, and it starts behaving incorrectly. For example, hangs or crashes or starts consuming resources uncontrollably, such as CPU and memory. Or it could simply be that it serves requests incorrectly and being perfect in other ways. How would you approach the problem? It is not always possible to attach a debugger to a process in production and inspect it. So usually developers add login statements to record what their code is doing during execution to aid in troubleshooting and debugging. When an application or service is being executed, the output of such login code is either collected from a console or from some login file for later analysis, which can also be done in real time for alerting. Such logging is also sometimes called tracing, especially if we are interested in the whole operating system behavior. So sometimes you use logging and tracing at the same time. So there's no much difference for me. So if you have this question, what's the difference between them? So sometimes collecting logs from a specific process or system is not enough, as we need some contextual information. We need to know who launched the process, how our process works with others, and follow data from it to other parts of the system, and even other computers in a distributed environment. So to get full information, we collect logs from other parts as well in parallel. It is also called distributed tracing. It's my interpretation. So some may disagree what distributed tracing is, but this is from my experience. Such contextual tracing is very important as it supplements missing information. For example, a process may write to a file, but doesn't log access errors. Such errors may be visible from operating system trace. So another example is cloud environments, where Kubernetes logs may need to be supplemented by system logs. So all these logs and traces are usually textual, but may include binary information as well. Therefore, they need to be analyzed for indicators and signs of abnormal structure and behavior. So basically, this is an anomaly detection task.
Gotcha.
So we also need trends, provide insights into code execution, and ultimately find a root cause, give troubleshooting and debugging recommendations. So maybe many people may be involved in solving production environments, from customers to technical support to developers to even to management. So answering this question, trace and log analysis is the diagnostic analysis of execution artifacts for indicators, signs, and symptoms of abnormal structure and behavior in a specific context. So what are contexts in this case? So could be failures.
It's okay if we can slow down a little bit. These are a lot of concepts that are coming one after another. So it sounds like you have there's a lot of data collection, of course. There's a lot of understanding distributed systems. And at the core of it, the goal of trace and log analysis is, like, if there was, what was like the most important mission of your day-to-day in helping out your, in a technical system?
Yes, and trace and lock analysis could be done in a variety of contexts. So it could be like failures in production environment. It could be security issues. Find some intrusion detection, for example, detect intrusion.
Right.
Could be also usability. So we want to see all these clicks, how they go, what delay between them, and so on. So well, this massive application of trace and lock analysis. And in my long career, I focused exclusively on software diagnostics for many years, and actually 14 years exactly. Before I was a software engineer, and after that I'm software engineer as well. So initially I focused on a memory dump analysis, but later also became working with trace and logs and started kind of doing trace and log analysis from distributed client server systems. So generally, like initially it all came, like for example, snapshots of computer memory can be considered a trace too. Especially when you feed memory into a debugger and then it starts outputting a lot of information in textual format for analysis, because we are not able to read binary.
Right.
Everything. So we need to convert this into trace. So, and a debugger, so a debugger itself can generate massive logs. For example, while dumping memory contents with symbolic information or stack traces from all processes and threads, especially if this is done periodically. So I hope I explained why traces and logs are important by providing some context. And I have not even started on digital forensics, security event monitoring as a part of security information and event management.
I'm sure we're just scratching the surface when it comes to like the density of work that you're doing and how important it is. And I think for a lot of people who are listening, you know, many people of course might be from our community, pretty advanced when it comes to their coding, but some people might have some time to get around what you do and why it's so important, you know. And you know, in our prior discussion, you talked a lot about like anytime there was an error screen or a pinwheel or something that indicates something going wrong, but we're not exactly sure why, that information is valuable to you. So I'd love to know a little bit more about, you know, whether these problems are user-generated, system-generated, developer-generated, all of the above, and what are ways in order to identify and prevent these kinds of errors?
Okay, so so you want to know what are the most kind of common reasons, root causes of such errors, right?
You know, let's start there, why don't we? Yeah.
Okay, so, and according to my experience, what I found after all these years, there are two main reasons for that. Okay. So basically code defects, bugs in code, not following code requirements, that's kind of obvious. So that's developers usually fix. But there is another reason, and this is the complexity of the execution environment. So a well-tested component, module, process, a subsystem may not be able to function in a complex environment, especially if it is kind of environment out there, not in a controlled production environment. So you test some component and then you distribute it in the wild. So say to a million of computers out there, it would be like desktop computers, for example, right? You know, so, and this environment is complex because you don't know what other components will be there at any particular time, right? And your well-tested component may not be able to function in that complex environment because of others, or may prevent others to work correctly. So you need to analyze the whole system to get logs and traces from the whole system and see. In addition, you may also need to take memory dumps also and look for hints at past system. So maybe some hints at past system behavior. So you need to look at this and find out what is the problem. And I also want to talk about some common analysis approaches to this. So there are many approaches to such tracing logs, how to analyze them, to identify common recurrent problems. So in addition to looking at tracing logs and trying to search, we also need to do some data transformations as well, because it's not always kind of a search for particular pattern. So you need to transform data and get in a different form. So all these approaches and techniques, that's what I call tracing log analysis patterns. So here stress is on analysis. Kind of approaches, techniques, data transformations, commands in debugger you need to do, or some operations you need to do in a tracing log analysis tool in some abstract form. So here again, I stress the keys on analysis. So, and these patterns, they form a pattern language with a pattern catalog that covers all that and even more, since every execution and forensic artifact and even the output of tools that process them into some format can be considered as a tracing log. So everything can be considered as a tracing log, and we need kind of a patterns, pattern language to analyze. So, and I also want to talk about how I created this as well. So.
Sure. I mean, while you're elaborating more on your own work in this, I'd love to know what are the wisdom and what kind of things that you learned over your career to optimize and make sure that these systems are as efficient as they can get when it comes to identifying like errors, right?
Yes. That's how to identify and prevent, you mean, right? You know, how to prevent these errors.
Right. Yeah. I guess that's another question. In addition to that is, you know, when the errors occur, they occur, but is your work more involved in preventing the errors from happening, or is it more involved in triaging them once they do, or is it a little bit of both?
Most of my career, I was acting like a diagnostician, like think about GP. So when you go to your GP, you know, GP does diagnostics about, you know, reported problems, right? So like I tell my high level description of the problem. And so, and then, you know, I may go to some analysis, detections, everything. And then, you know, GP or some analyst may kind of tell, actually, the goal here is actually to do the right, to do the proper diagnostics. So the proper diagnostics is important before problem solving. So first we need to diagnose the right problem and pick up the root cause. So there's no point of solving the problem if it is not diagnosed correctly. So think about, again, about medical kind of analogies.
You can go to
GP and you are sent, you know, for troubleshooting. So that's what I'm saying.
That sounds like a really good analogy for the work you do, is to think about it almost in medical terms, right? You know, we're looking for symptoms, but we're also trying to make sure that the symptoms don't ever really occur if possible. Is that fair to say?
Yes. So we first need to collect relevant artifacts to do analysis. Then we need to look at these artifacts, traces and logs, use analysis patterns, and try to find out this kind of right symptoms, signs, and based on that, we make recommendations.
Okay.
And of course, you know, it's different of work I used to do, like sometimes I also used to solve the problem as well. Right. But most of the time I used to be kind of a diagnostician. So that's why I was able to develop kind of the comprehensive system of these tracing log analysis patterns. Similar to what design patterns are for construction, these are for post-construction phase.
Got it.
Because I was focusing only on one important part, mostly, not the whole kind of problem solving.
Right. And the problem is, as you've described, is pretty immense and complicated. So I think even focusing on one area can do a lot to impact these things. So this has really been fascinating, Dmitry. And, you know, we've more or less come to the end of our questioning, as we've answered a lot of things in out of order, but that's totally fine. So I want to give you an opportunity to talk a little bit more about you and the kind of work you're doing, and also any causes or any lessons that you'd like to share to the community. The floor is yours.
So basically again, I kind of stress that the stress is on analysis.
Uh-huh.
So, and I want to talk about this kind of analysis and pattern language. So when creating such analysis patterns and giving them names, I took kind of an interdisciplinary approach. There are many similarities across textual artifacts in many disciplines. Mm-hmm. For example, semiotics, study of science,
right,
in artifacts that carry meaning, or narratology, study of narratives. Mm-hmm. So we can consider traces and logs as software narratives telling us the story of computation. So imagine like some agent trying to get access to a castle, you know, this case, like a file and so on. So also I drew much inspiration from contemporary mathematics, and these analysis patterns are mainly for humans. This is another stress, but some can be mapped to a rule-based or machine learning algorithmic approaches, and some are old methods, obvious, but we need to name obvious things. So for communication or structuring our analysis reports, but some analysis patterns are entirely novel. So all of them you can find if you go to traceanalysis.org or dumpanalysis.org website. This is actually called Software Diagnostics Institute. So being in university for many years, I always wanted to have my own institute.
Nice.
So, and it's very easy to name.
Isn't that the dream, right? That's very cool.
So, and that actually, I published a book, actually several books about trace and log analysis. It's called like Trace and Log Analysis Patterns. And now the fourth edition is called Trace Log Text Narrative or something like that. And from that book, Educative actually made a course called A Guide to Learning Software Tracing Log Analysis Patterns. And it is actually structured as a dictionary of analysis pattern names with hundreds of pictures. And you need a dictionary because this is a language. So when you learn pattern language, it's like learning a foreign language. So you need a dictionary. And if it is visual, it's even better. So this kind of dictionaries has hundreds of examples and diagrams, hundreds of diagrams, and this language is actually tool independent because there are a lot of similarities between different logs and traces, and you can use this pattern language to structure and communicate your analysis results. And so that's what I wanted to kind of tell. And
wonderful. Well, that's a lot of stuff. You're gonna have to send me some of those links later so that we make sure we share them with our community. But I think it's incredible the work that you're doing, and it's, you know, rich and complex, but at the same time it's accessible because we've all been there, right? We've all been in the moment where something goes wrong and we wish someone would do something about it. And that is literally your passion, right? That's your career, is to do something about it, whether it's preventative or whether it's an attempt to, you know, do it in a triage way. Both are very impressive works. So I want to thank you so much, Dmitry, for being on the show, you know, really just sharing so much of your brilliant insights. And I also want to thank anybody that's watching this on YouTube or listening to us on any major podcasting platform. You can find out more of this content on these sites as well. And you can also check out more about ourselves as well at educative.io. So for all of us here at Educative, thank you so much and happy learning. Bye-bye now.
Thank you.
Hello there. Lee here from Educative. Hope you enjoyed this latest episode with Educative Sessions. If you liked this episode, please click on the like button somewhere. You can find more episodes on YouTube or on any major podcasting app. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. It actually helps us a lot. Happy learning.